Hello everyone, welcome to today's webinar, Earn That Promotion, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. My name is Bridget Holmes and I work in Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is John Kaiser, College 59, a business leadership coach. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community, and we had 191 alums registered. And we currently have over 40 alums on the line. I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar on our website within 3 business days. There are 2 audio options for today's webinar. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It's important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Our presenter today is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A portion of this presentation. PowerPoint slides will be emailed to you after the presentation. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today, John Kaiser. John Kaiser, College 59, has had a long career as a senior executive with Johnson & Higgins and then after a merger with Marsh & McLennan. His principal responsibilities and his passions were superior client service, understanding specifically what his clients needed and wanted all around the world, and delivering to that standard, as well as training and developing his company's people so they can maximize their success. He's a believer in Tom Peters' principle, pay close attention to and take care of your people, and they will pay attention to and take good care of your clients. He subsequently joined nonprofit organizations, first as an executive director of Damon Runyon Cancer Research Foundation, and then as head of development for the Georgetown University Medical Center. John is a Georgetown University liberal arts graduate and also a graduate of the Georgetown Leadership Coaching Program, which is accredited by the International Coaching Federation. Thank you so much, John, for your time today. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay, thanks, Emily. And hello, everyone. I am very happy to be with you, and I sure hope I can deliver some good ideas, ideas of value to you. One of the things I'd like to mention is although my business experience was in insurance and risk management and healthcare and development and fundraising, to me, all businesses are people businesses. So I don't think these ideas are industry specific. They cross all fields. Let me go to the next visual. Emily? So I'm hitting the space bar and it's not advancing.
Okay, hold on 1 second and I will be right with you.
Hang with us for a moment. Okay, good. Sorry about that. Okay, the next visual is about coaching. I work with high-level executives and also up-and-comers, and the key ingredient for me is I want to work with people who believe in continuous improvement, who understand that you've got to try and get better each and every day, and that's going to be a theme of what we talk about this afternoon, the urge to be your best self. And coaching is really about looking at the future. It differs from therapy and mentoring and advising and counseling and so on, because we briefly visit with my clients, I briefly visit the past. What do I need to know? And then we look to the future, and it's what do you want to achieve? What would you like to change? What are your dreams maybe? And then to the present about, okay, what needs to happen so you can make those accomplishments? I've thought about in the hour we're going to spend, what I would like to give you as takeaways, what will help you succeed in your business. And there are a ton of principles, and I've picked seven. I think those seven are very, very important and will be great helps for you. And let me give you a little background. On my website, I write each week about leadership and sometimes about career advancement. And last summer, I wrote a piece on, and the name of it was Earn That Promotion. And it's really the basis for this conversation today. It went up on a Monday morning. That afternoon, I received a phone call from a young person who I know very well, who had just graduated from Georgetown with a master's degree. And he said, John, I really liked what you wrote. I got a lot out of it. And I was surprised because he had just graduated with his master's. And I said to him, Chris, didn't they teach you that in your program? And he was silent for like a minute as he was thinking. And he said, you know, in thinking about it, I think what they taught us was how to be a high-level executive, but not how to get there. And then just by pure coincidence, the next day I received a phone call from another person who had graduated recently from Georgetown with his master's in real estate finance, a different master's program from Chris. And he said to me, I really enjoyed what you wrote. Good stuff. Thank you very much. And I said, well, in fact, coincidentally, I received a phone call just yesterday from Chris, who he knows, who said it was something that they really should be teaching us in school. And he said, you know, I work for a big company, and companies should be telling its employees what you wrote about career advancement. So that's a, therefore, that triggered my writing something. Actually, I've been meaning to do it, and it was just posted on my website yesterday about what companies should tell employees to create a exciting, collaborative, supportive company culture. So I went up yesterday around 1 o'clock, and I have had a ton of feedback in the way of emails from people saying, thank you, I really enjoyed reading that. So at any rate, that's the basis for the phone call, the conversation we're going to have today. As Bridget said, I will we will email you copies of these visuals. I also would like to recommend some readings, a couple of articles or books that are short, quick reads, but I think they're enormously useful. I've given them to some of my clients, some of my friends, and I've gotten, you know, people just said it was really terrific. Thank you very much. Really got a lot out of it. So I'd be happy to share that with you. And the other thing is I will take the liberty of signing you up to receive my weekly posts about leadership and career advancement. Doesn't cost anything. You might get some good ideas from it. And if you don't want them, absolutely no problem. Just decline them. So, but I'll sign you up, and it's up to you whether you take them or not. Okay, now let's go to the takeaways. I have become the most valuable player, or a most valuable player, for all you do. the value of asking a ton of questions, finding out what success looks like. Be an active, intentional listener. And I'm going to talk some about the importance of being an active listener and what a difference that can make. Being a great teammate, how important your boss is to you, the fact that humility is the foundation of growth, and some of the things that that will enable you to do so well. And then the importance of being respected, trusted, and liked. And then a hidden gem, which I'll talk about, what a difference it makes to be early. And then I'm going to talk some specifically about some issues that women face. I'm old enough that when I entered the workforce, while 50% of the employees were women, they were at the time called secretaries and file clerks. There were so many people who were close friends of mine, I'd get promoted, they wouldn't, and it would drive me nuts. So I started to fight on their behalf, and been doing that for 40 years. And fortunately, the world has changed so much for the better. But there still could be some issues, and I'll touch briefly on that. Okay. Now, I would like you to, looking at these seven takeaways, which you think is the most important. And I'd love to get what you think about that. So, Emily, what do? They just click the...
Yep, if everyone could just click on which one of these takeaways they feel is most important. The poll is now open, and people are voting. I'm going to give you a couple seconds.
They vote for more than one?
You know what? I'm not sure.
So let's leave it for one. Let's leave it for one for right now.
Okay, great. We still have people voting. Let's see. Give people another couple seconds. People are still voting. All right. Looks like most people have voted. So we're going to go ahead and close the poll. And let me share the results with you. Can you see the results there? About 40% said become an MVP, 12% said asking purposeful questions, 12% said being an intentional listener, 20% said being a great teammate, and about 16% say having humility as your foundation.
Okay. So it was kind of a trick question on my part. In my everyone's right. And in my opinion, based on my experience, the answer is all of them. You got to do all of them. If you really want to be successful, every one of these things is important for you to do. So let me go to the next one. So with that in mind, we're going to get into each one. Okay, becoming a most valuable player. Nothing beats being promoted by your peers for all you do, for the work you do, the good work you do, the help you give them, the positive spark that you bring to the team or the company. And, this means you don't have a big ego. This means you help everyone succeed as well as doing great work yourself. You do what's needed. I want to tell you a story about JWG, John, and the way he took, when he started, the way he took work off people's desks. I interviewed John. He had been with another firm, one of the most prestigious financial institutions in the world. He had been there for 5 years, was on a fast track, clearly was very successful, and he came to us and wanted to interview for a job. My boss had a big question, because why would he leave where he was? There's an unhidden story here someplace. But I spent a lot of time, a number of interviews with John and other people did as well. And I was, I became convinced he wanted to change because where he was very structured, and he liked the fact that where we were, we got good people. When we undermanage, we gave people the leeway to use their best judgment. What impressed me most about John was, during the number of times I interviewed him, he was leaning three-quarters of the way across the desk. He was so driven and excited, and that made an impression on me. Also, whenever we walked to another office or walked down the hallway or something, he was practically running. And I just felt, wow, this guy's just full of energy, and he is a real driver. And so I said to my boss, I think this is a good risk. I'll take responsibility. I want to hire him. And so we got permission, and I have never in my 40-plus years of business seen anyone progress so quickly. He didn't know our field, but he was driven to contribute value, to help people, to learn the business as quickly as he could. And he just every single day went around and to people's offices and said, "What are you doing? Please let me do that for you." And a lot of people, of course, would say, "You know, no, it'd take me longer to explain it to you than it would if I just did it myself and I'm busy." And he would just say, "Please, I'm a quick learn. Just tell me what you want, and I'll give it to you as soon as I can." And he would just collect work, and in the desire to learn our business and to be a great teammate and contribute value. And I was amazed, because at the end of the day, he would have stacks of stuff on his desk, and it would be on all of our desks the next morning. I don't know whether he stayed all night, but he might have, to do all he did. And he really, really progressed quicker than anyone I ever saw. And in fact, he became the executive vice president of our company. The other story is GST, Gail, a woman who I've been coaching for a number of months. She was about 20 years with a financial institution that went under during the recession a couple of years ago, and they finally closed their doors this past spring. She's very smart, Ivy League educated, attractive, well-spoken, ton of contacts, and just was a very successful person. And a difficult situation because she's a single mom. And at any rate, so she was out, as were, you know, everyone with this company. And fortunately, she had a network of good people, and she worked that network hard looking for another job. And she ended up with three opportunities, but it was a blow to her. It took almost 9 months for her to get these opportunities. And when she finally got the three opportunities, I was very excited for her, and she discussed which one to pick, and she did, and it was a great opportunity. I'm thrilled. And then she said, "We need to talk some more." And it turns out, I didn't realize it before, but this was really a blow to her confidence, and she was scared. She was saying, "Well, what if they don't like me, or what if they think I know more than I actually do know? What if I don't relate well to the people?" It's just like she had just lost her confidence. So we had several hours of discussion about that, and I basically said to her, "You know, like, how do you think you could become a most valuable player in the next, you know, in the first month you're there?" And she said, "Okay, well, that's a good idea. Let me think about that." And she would come up with ideas about, in essence, how she can help people with their work, which would help her learn, help her gain the respect of her colleagues, her new colleagues, and so on. And
I was just with her last week, and she's now been there about 6 weeks and is thrilled, and everything's going well. But it was really by how can I help be a great teammate. And okay, the next takeaway is asking questions, finding out what is expected, what's needed, what's wanted of me, and what success looks like. I cannot tell you how important I think this is. Understanding what your boss expects, needs, and wants from you, and the same thing with your clients, same thing with your internal clients or your colleagues, and really what success looks like for you, for the team you're on, part of, for the company, and then each client, they're each going to have probably individual wants and needs, and they're entitled to that. So I don't think we can assume what clients want or what your boss wants or what our colleagues want, and it's very important to ask these questions. And based on my experience, this can make a huge difference for you. And also, you know, one of the causes of problems in an office, just in our life, in the world, is poor communication. And I believe in, for example, asking my boss, well, how would you like me to keep you posted on what I'm doing? I used to do that with when I was with Johnson & Higgins. And, you know, one person who ran one of the divisions for me would say, you know, what I want to do, is to write you a note every Friday, you know, a one-pager with summarizing what's happened, what we've done, what's still to be accomplished, what's in the works, any problems. Another person said, I would like to have a meeting with you every Friday. Just a short meeting. It'll take 10 minutes. I'll run through my to-do list from Monday and what's been done and what's still to be done. Another person said, John, what I'd like to do is every Monday morning stick my head in your office and just, I don't even need to sit down. I'm just going to rattle off what's happened last week and what I think you need to know. And all that was fine. I mean, we were on the same page. I knew what how they wanted to communicate with me, and that was fine. If I didn't like it, I would have told them and they would have changed. But so, you know, I think understanding exactly how to communicate with the people you work with and with your clients is very important. And, interesting. I used to see sometimes write voluminous reports or proposals, include all kinds of stuff, background on our company, lots of references, biographical information for the people on the team and stuff, and the clients didn't want it. And all they wanted was, give me bullets, bullet points. What do you recommend we do and why? And I don't want all the rest of that stuff. And if you give them too much stuff, you know, they put it in their briefcase and take it home. And very seldom does someone make a decision at home. They usually make it when they're in their office. So, all right, questions are extremely important. And in my opinion, finding out, asking about what you don't know, finding out what's expected of you, what success looks like and for you and the team and the company and from your clients is a sign of confidence. And not asking is a sign of insecurity and is not smart. By background, I believe that everyone wants to do well. Everyone wants to succeed, and everyone can succeed. mean, yes, it takes hard work, but it sure is worth it. So then if everyone wants to do well, everyone wants to succeed, why doesn't everyone succeed? And to me, the answer is insecurity gets in the way of some people. They are hesitant to admit they don't know something and hesitant to ask the questions. And by the way, I also think insecurity is what causes some people not to be good leaders because they're afraid to have conversations with people they work with. They hide in their office. They hide behind their title and that kind of stuff. And to me, that's just a sign of insecurity. Great, great quote. This is by, I think it was by Kipling. Everything I know, I learned from my 6 best friends. What, how, why, who, when, and where. And I believe that if we ask a lot of questions that, you know, people will respect that, that we have a strong desire to learn and that we are curious. We have a strong sense of curiosity. Believe me, my experience tells me that people have lots of respect for that. Okay, the next one is listening. I wish I could sit down with each one of you and have a conversation about this because I believe this is so vital. When I took the Georgetown Leadership Coaching Program a couple of years ago, which was a dynamite program, by the way. One of the first things they emphasized is the importance of listening. And yes, I knew it was important, but I don't think I had ever really thought about listening and the different levels of listening and so on. Based on what I learned in that program early on, it caused me to want to learn more, and I went on the internet and started researching listening and picked a book. It's called The Listening Leaders, and it was a great book, and it validated just how important listening is with stories. And it's very interesting because listening is not something we were ever taught in school. At no level did they teach you how to listen, and to be honest with you, there are not a lot of books about listening. The one I read, which was called Listening Leaders, was certainly very good. It was way longer than it needed to be. I actually could recommend a short 32-page pamphlet, and I could put it in my in the recommended reading material that I send to you. But it's by the Center of Creative Leadership, which is around for 30 years, does really, really good work. And they have a 32-page book that has everything you need to know. What they don't have is a ton of stories. It just validates it. But listening is vital. And, you know, it's really a state of mind. Do I really want to listen quietly to someone to understand how she or he thinks, feels, why they feel that way, quieting your mind so that you're not making judgments. What is the person saying? What is she not saying? How does she feel? I know for me and probably for most of the people on this call, you know, your mind tends to be problem solving as you're listening to someone. Okay, I know what she should do, or this is what I'm going to say when it's my turn to talk, and you know, you're thinking about those kinds of things instead of really seeking to be receptive and understanding what the person is saying. Helpful hints would be, you know, to maintain comfortable eye contact, lean forward. That means so much. I mean, something I always notice when I'm pleased when I'm talking and I see someone leaning forward and I think, okay, good. They're receptive to what I have to say. And the whole thing about affirming and nodding. And, let me tell you a story about pausing or silence. Through LinkedIn, I heard from just a couple of years ago from someone I had worked with and had not seen for more than 10 years and had not been in touch with. You know, we were good friends and just kind of lost touch when our company was sold and stuff, and we were on different coasts of the United States. And so she found me on LinkedIn, or I found her, I forget. And we started exchanging emails, and I said, what's going on in your life and work and stuff? And she said, oh, you know, I have a partner now who I would love you to meet. Her name is Ann Ada. And she's a great person. I hope someday you'll get a chance to meet her. She's smart, very successful and stuff. And I'll send you a profile. She was just written up in the local magazine because she is so highly respected in the business community here. So she, the next day, she emailed me a copy of the magazine article. And it was so interesting because they interviewed four people that worked with her, a couple external people. They were clients and a couple, one was a peer, a colleague, and the other was her boss. And they all had the same theme, that in a conversation, she would have pauses and look very thoughtfully and obviously was processing what the person had said, but she always took time to answer. And it had the same effect on all four of these people being interviewed. She showed them great respect, and she was very thoughtful about what they had to say. So it kind of validates the importance of silence. Being an intentional listener, and you know, Chuck, I've heard people say we have two ears and one mouth for a reason, and we should spend. That would mean we'd spend 67% of our time listening and 33% talking, and even better in something I recently read by, I think it was by the Center of Creative Leadership, that shoot to spend 80% of our time listening. I mentioned this thing about motivation. Numerous studies about what the key motivators are, and even more than how much we're paid, even more than what title we hold, is the desire to feel appreciated, to be valued, feel valued, and to be heard. And I think that being a good listener will help people feel good about themselves and feel appreciated and valued and so on. Okay, the next one, takeaway, is being a great teammate, something that got a lot of votes and with very good reason. I have an idea here as I was preparing this that I think everyone on this call is going to have some good ideas about how to be a great teammate, and your ideas will be every good as mine. So what I am suggesting is that in the next, by 10 p.m. tomorrow night, 10 p.m. Eastern time tomorrow night, so day and a half, just write some cryptic notes and send them in to us here. And what I'd like to do is compile all the answers, collect them all, and synthesize the answers. I think there will be a wealth of good ideas about how to be a great teammate. And then we'll send them back to you. So it will be a Georgetown answer. I need to tell you, I am going to a client meeting, a three-day company meeting, out of town next week. And so being out of town, it's really 4 days. We may not get this back to you till the week after next. Try and get back next week. But I would guess, I can't wait to see the ideas that you contribute, because I think there'll be some great stuff. So if you would do that, that'd be great. The next thing I want to mention as a takeaway is your boss is important to you. You know, yeah, duh, who doesn't know that? Except I have to tell you, so many people I talk with say to me, my boss is clueless, my boss is just okay, or my boss is weak, or my boss doesn't do this or that, or whatever. So what I'd like to encourage you to do is realize just how important your boss is to your career. If your boss, if she or he is your advocate, that's going to be a huge help. If they're, you're not on the same page, it sure doesn't help your career. And I'm not talking about buttering up your boss or anything like that. I am talking about, you know, sitting down with your boss. And you know, one thing I say is I think it's okay to say, you know what, I would like to have a job like yours. You don't have to say, I want your job, because that may be a problem, but I want a job like yours. I want to earn it. I'd love your advice. I would love you to feel that, you know, someday I'm going to be good enough that I can have that job. So to the extent that you can get your boss rooting for you, giving you advice, helping you advance, that'd be great. So I just get concerned that so many people don't feel that way, don't encourage their boss to give them advice. That you know, I want everyone on this phone call to feel that, okay, that's a good idea. Yeah, sure, you're going to have problems, and when you do, try and fix it, let it fester. And to me, if you have a, if you do have a problem, the idea of sitting down and saying, as I've written at the bottom of this visual, is my doing well is good for me, good for you, good for our company. May I share with you what I need from you to help me do my best work? Hopefully a boss will be responsive to that. I would sure hope so. If if they're not, then that's a problem, but a big problem. And by the way, I have to tell you, I had some great bosses in my life, and a couple that were less so. And the two regrets that I have in my business career were not fixing the problem I had with the two bosses that I was not on the same page, I didn't respect. If I could turn back the clock, I would have done things differently and had a better relationship with those two people. Those are my two biggest regrets of my career. Okay, the next one is, humility is the foundation of growth. And I think this is so important, because this enables us to ask questions, to admit we don't know something, to admit that we can improve, that we can get better. And I believe a motto for each of us in business, for, you know, for a football team, a basketball team, for a wife or a husband or brother or sister, is I can always be better. And I want to be better, and I'm going to ask for feedback, and I'm going to, in case of business, it would be feedback from colleagues, from boss, from clients. What can I do better? What would you like to see me do better? And I have to tell you, I think it's very attractive to be vulnerable, to and I don't have anything about self-reflection here on the visual, but self-reflection is critically important. That, you know, at the end of the day or at the end of the week or something, okay, what did I do well? What could I have done better? And I encourage the spirit, the quiet confidence of, I know I'm good, and I know that I can be even better. And it's still that in the team and the company that you're part of. Yeah, we are good, and we can be even better. That keeps us hungry and aggressive, and I believe it's very, very much of a critical success factor. Our next visual is be respected, trusted, and liked. And people do business with people who they believe will deliver, who believe will always be there to help them, and who they want to do business with. And so to the extent that we can become, have a personal relationship as well as a professional relationship, I think that that can be very helpful at times. And I'm going to talk about that more a little later, but the idea of if there's a client or prospective client, the idea of having a relationship outside the office, whether you meet for coffee or dinner with spouses or friends or go to a ball game or play golf or go to the theater or something or other. These are things you can't rush. You can't ask too early. And it's only if and when it would be appropriate. But if you can develop that kind of a relationship, that there is an honest and genuine friendship aside from a business relationship, it sure does help. You get, sometimes it preserves relationships when there's competition. Sometimes you get some helpful information about the competition and so on. So it's worth striving for, but you have to be very careful because it also could backfire if you try to establish it at an inappropriate time, too soon, or whatever. So just something to keep in mind. It was very helpful to me in my career and very helpful to other people that were good friends of mine, and I saw how good they were at establishing those. The last takeaway for today is be early, always. And to me, this is a hidden gem. It's a hidden success factor. I don't know when I got this little card that I have in my wallet, but someone famous said, the secret to my success is I am always 15 minutes ahead of time. I promise you, I cannot emphasize enough how helpful this can be. Just a couple of weeks ago, a friend of mine said, hey, John, I'm going to give you an introduction, email introduction to a friend who's in New York. You guys should know each other, even though you're in D.C. Somehow or other, you should meet. This guy's a hardworking, very successful guy, president of a company, and he's a maniac with his work habits, but I think you'll have a lot of respect for his ideas, and it would be someone you would enjoy knowing. So I said, great. I emailed Kurt and said, you know, I'd love to meet you, and our mutual friend says we'd have a good time talking, and he said, perfect, I am coming to D.C. in 2 weeks. How about that Friday, meet you 3 o'clock at the lobby of the Hilton, and we'll have a beer or a cup of coffee or something or other. So I got there early, was sitting in the lobby, had my briefcase open. This guy rushes in the lobby, picks up his phone. He's going to call me to make sure that I'm in the right Hilton because there's more than one in downtown D.C. And he's looking at me when he dials the number because he has no idea that I'm John Kaiser, but I answer my phone and I look up and I see this big smile on his face. And I just knew that he was impressed that he was early, and he was impressed that I, too, was early. So, you know, we shook hands, went in, sat down, had a cup of coffee, and within about 30 minutes, he said, how can we do business together? I attribute that to getting off on such a good start that he liked the fact that I was there early, and it showed him that I was eager and whatever. So there were a number of times in my business career when if I had a 2 o'clock meeting or a 10 o'clock meeting or presentation or whatever, and I got there, you know, say at 20 of 10, and would be sitting there, and whoever I was presenting to or meeting with came out of her or his office and saw me, they smiled, and they said, wow, glad you're here. Sometimes they even invited me in, and we talked about something unrelated to what the meeting was about, waiting for other people to come. Sometimes that didn't happen, but the person's executive assistant said, can I get you a glass of water? And we'd start to talk, and I would get useful information. So I just encourage you that being early is a hidden success factor and something you won't read about in books, but I believe it will serve you very well. Okay, these were the takeaways we talked about. And in that paper that I mentioned, Earn That Promotion, there were at least twice this number. But I didn't want to just, I wanted to be able to talk about takeaways and tell you some stories. Hopefully they were worth something to you. And there are others, takeaways that, you know, if you think this was of value, I'd be happy to do another webinar and pick 7 more that I think are also very important. You know, things like making things happen and planning and setting priorities, that kind of stuff. But we just don't have enough time to do it. So these 7 takeaways, if they guide your business career, I promise you, good things will happen. Now, let me talk just briefly about the situation with women. Everything that, or every one of those takeaways, women can do, and some even better. Definitely, I think listening would be interesting because I'm, I should probably ask people, except we don't have time. But I think humility is something where women would have an advantage through listening and asking questions. Women would have an advantage. But let me tell you the story of Christine. She's someone who I worked with, she was dynamite, just dynamite. Very, very smart and very conscientious. And one day we sat for hours, and she said to me, you have such an advantage because you become friendly with our clients and our prospective clients. You take them out for drinks, or you take them to, you know, football or baseball or basketball games, and you have them to your house for dinner. I can't do that. I'm a single woman. I can't take guys out for drinks. I can't have them to my apartment on a Saturday night the way you can. And we have to find, these things are important. Having those kind of relationships, how can you do it? And we talked at length, and I wanted to try and help her come up with the answers, and we did. I mean, you know, basically, every one of the things that she felt that I did that was helpful for me, that she could do, and, you know, if she wanted to have a dinner party, or if she wanted to take people out for drinks, and, you know, she got nervous after they had a couple of drinks, and happen and stuff. So just invite me or invite someone else from the office. You know, you don't have to do it by yourself. The idea that you can do these things They are important, and just do them. And she started to do that, and she developed better relationships than I ever had. And it was just finding a way to make it happen, and finding a way to make it happen on in a way that she was comfortable doing. My story about golf, I've written a piece that I also could send you, or you could access on my website, about how important business golf is, and solely because you get to spend 5 or 6 hours with someone. Golf takes typically almost 5 hours to play, and you usually have a sandwich or a beer or a Coke afterwards or something or other. So you're talking 6 hours quiet time with someone, and what an opportunity it is. When I worked for Johnson & Higgins in New York, I was sent to Chicago to jazz up the Chicago office, and we'd been there for 100 years and we were not growing, and we wanted to be much more of a presence. So one day I'm flying across the country with a friend of mine who ran our Cleveland office, and at the time I was running our Chicago office, and we left New York flying to LA and sitting next to one another, and Jim asked me how much business golf I play, and I said, I don't play any. I play a little golf on weekends, but I do not play golf during the week. And he said, why? And I said, I don't want to set that example. And he said, you're a fool. He said, let me tell you what I do. Every spring, I make a list of all the clients and prospective clients that I want to spend 5 hours with, and I make a list of every person in our company, in the office, that I want to spend 5 hours with. And I do that in April, and in May I begin to make phone calls and invite people for, and I play golf every Tuesday afternoon and every Thursday afternoon. We tee off like 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and do that in the during the summer months. And I line up my foursomes at the beginning of the spring. So it made a big impression on me, and I decided, you know what, I'm going to do that, and I'm going to take it one step further. I'm going to try never to have an all-male foursome. I'm going to try to include at least one woman in each of those rounds of golf to the extent that I can. So I had a very interesting thing, because when I would ask people to play with me, some of the guys who didn't play golf very well and a lot of the women who were not golfers at the time said, oh, I can't possibly do that. I would be so nervous. I'd thanks for the invitation, but I don't want to do it because I would be too nervous. And I said, you know what, I'll get you a golf lesson before you, then if you want, but, you know, just come out with us. If you hit a couple of grounders and you feel like you're holding us up, it's not how well you play golf, it's how quick you play golf. So just if you hit a couple grounders and you don't feel like playing the rest of the hole, just look at us and laugh and say, I'm going to pick up the ball and kibitz the rest of this hole, and I'll see you on the next tee. And it was huge. So the women turned out were very glad they started to do that. And we had many years of fun and laughs and the relationships. I mean, it's just such a great advantage, and not for men, but it can be for women as well, to be able to spend that kind of time with people. So there isn't a whole bunch of time for questions, but if you would send in questions now, we can take a few minutes and answer them, and I would be happy to, collect the questions, answer each question, and send out an email to everyone in the next few days. So Emily?
Yes, thank you so much. If you would like to type in your questions at this point into the question box, we can do you have time, John, to take maybe one or two, and then the rest I can compile, and hopefully we can get the answers out to the group.
Yeah, absolutely I do, and I'm sorry, I guess I was long-winded.
No, I think that's great. I think this was great content.
Well, I sure hope this was helpful for everyone, and I love Georgetown and love everybody who went to Georgetown, so it means a lot to me, and I sure hope there was some value in this for you guys, and I'm happy to do it again and discuss the other takeaways I would love you to process or think about.
Great. Well, let's see if we can get to one or two questions. And, John, I'm sure we're going to have you back on our webinar circuit, so don't worry about that. Our first question is, how often do you recommend getting feedback from your boss in terms of how you're doing or what you're expected to do?
Yeah, and I don't know that there's a general answer to that. I mean, I think as frequently as appropriate. I mean, everybody's relationship or circumstances are different. I believe in getting feedback from your boss, and I just don't know whether I sure don't believe it's once a year or once every 6 months or once every 3 months. I think as often as appropriate given the situation. So I think feedback can be very helpful, honest, constructive, timely feedback. So however timely fits your situation, I think, is the answer.
Okay, great. Let's see. Our next question. How do you suggest dealing with a situation in which you might have made a mistake or taken on too much work and need to correct the situation?
Well, again, I think that is bringing it to the surface. Certainly admit mistakes, and I don't believe that you can get in nearly as much trouble by admitting a mistake as by hiding a mistake. That could be a disaster, and the error is human. So as long as there's a saying that a mistake only becomes an error if it's not corrected. So I believe in correcting mistakes immediately. If there's too much work, I just think you got to be honest and say, I can try and do all this, but I've got children at home, I've got this, that, and the other thing, and maybe it's too much. Can stay all night and do it, but I certainly think it's got to be brought to whether it's your boss or whoever, someone's attention, and say, can I share with you all that I have to do, and I'm not sure I can get it all done in the time frame and in the do the best possible job with this much to do. So I believe a problem discussed is a problem half solved. So that's what I believe is. Discuss it with someone.
Okay, great. Maybe we'll just do one more question, and then we will compile and send out. Do you have any specific suggestions, John, on improving the relationship with a boss you have problems with?
Well, I would go back to what I put on one of the visuals about, I want to do well, and if I do very good work, that only helps, not only helps me, it helps the team, it helps our company, it helps you as my boss, and so I'd like to find out what you expect, need, and want from me, and I would like to share with you what you can do to help me do my best work. And that ought to solve the problem. I can't say that it will in every situation, but again, a problem discussed as a problem, half solved. And I just think that attitude will help it if one is sincere in saying, you know, I want to do a really good job. And, you know, if we've had problems in the past, let's put them behind us. Let's talk about going forward. I want to do really good work, and I want to help you and this company. And, you know, hopefully that will enable it to be a much far better situation.
Great. Well, John, thank you so much for your time today. I know we have run out of time, but we are thrilled that you were able to join us today for the webinar, and look forward to having you back on our webinar circuit. Thank you to everyone for joining us.
Can I say one more thing?
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, I am open to feedback about what I had to say or how I had to say it, and I am not thin-skinned. I just want to, you know, be better the next time. So you've got my email, john@johnkaisercoach.com. So any feedback would be welcome and well-received, and please be honest. Okay. Thank
Great,
you.
And everyone, don't forget to send your emails to ac@georgetown.edu about your definition and understanding of kind of what it means to be a good teammate, and we will compile that and send that out to the group as well. John, thank you so much for your time. Thank you to all of our attendees. If you'd like to learn more about our other upcoming webinars, please visit alumni.georgetown.edu/careerservices for a full list of everything we have going on. Thank you so much, everyone, and have a great day.
Thank you.